Okay, welcome to the final Triangulum webinar, which will be about the wider impacts of Triangulum today. My name is Bettina Remmele and I'm from Steinbeis Europazentrum, which is responsible for dissemination and communication of Triangulum. Okay, so the webinar today will be about the wider impacts of Triangulum. There will be four presentations by our monitoring and evaluation specialists from the University of Manchester, James Evans, Kelly Watson, and Jo Lake Rees, and from Dujuan Yang from the Technical University of Eindhoven. The webinar will start with a brief overview of Triangulum, providing insights from its final year in terms of key lessons learned, leveraged value, and other benefits, replication potential, and so forth. We will present the Triangulum monitoring and assessment framework and results from our final year. Finally, we will provide an overview of our experience with SCIS, the Smart Cities Information System, including challenges of integrating this database into a live project. Each presentation will be about 15 minutes in length, and we will then take questions and encourage more of a discussion afterwards. You can ask questions by just unmuting yourself or by typing them into the chat box, whichever you prefer. Are there any urgent questions right away?
No.
Okay, perfect. Then let me get started by introducing Triangulum to you. So Triangulum is one of currently 17 smart city projects funded by Horizon 2020. And it's also one of the first three projects, and therefore we're ending this month, unfortunately. But let me start in the beginning. So the project budget, the overall project budget of Triangulum is or was 29 million euros, from which 25 million euros came from Horizon 2020 funding. Our consortium consists of 23 European partners in six different countries, and those include municipalities, research institutes, businesses, SMEs, and so forth. The project is coordinated by Fraunhofer IAO, which is located in Stuttgart, Germany, and it is supported by Steinbeis Europazentrum, which is also the company that I'm working for. The focus of Triangulum is on energy, mobility, and ICT, and the duration of the project was 5 years. We started in February 2015, and therefore we are ending this month in January 2020. Here you can see an overview of all partners that are involved in the project. So we have the project management by Fraunhofer IAO with support from University of Stuttgart and Steinbeis Europazentrum. And then we have three local consortia, one in Eindhoven, which is coordinated by the City of Eindhoven, one in Manchester, which is coordinated by the Manchester City Council, and one in Stavanger, which is coordinated by the City of Stavanger. And then we also have our three fellow cities, Prague, Sabadell, and Leipzig, which work jointly together and as part of the replication work package, which is coordinated by Fraunhofer Focus. And today we will hear inputs and presentations from our local Manchester partner, the University of Manchester, as well as the Technical University of Eindhoven from the City of Eindhoven. As I have said before, Triangulum is part of a larger community, so to say. This community consists currently of 17 European smart city projects, which are all co-funded by Horizon 2020. And you can see Triangulum is at the very bottom together with Remo Urban and Grow Smarter, which means that those three projects are the first three that have started. They are the first generation projects. And the one at the very top, Atelier, Positive, and Sparks, are the three latest projects, so to say, which have just started at the end of last year. As you know by now, we have three lighthouse cities, Manchester, Eindhoven, and Stavanger. And we have three fellow cities, Prague, Sabadell, and Leipzig. Okay, that was so much for a short introduction to Triangulum. I hope there are no open questions, so that we can now get started with the main part of this webinar. So we will start with Professor James Evans from the University of Manchester. James Evans is a professor of geography at the University of Manchester, where he studies how cities learn to become smarter and more sustainable. He has worked with over 200 organizations around the world to implement collaborative ways of working towards sustainability, and he has set up the University Living Lab in 2014. He is currently the University Lead for Sustainability and the Manchester Urban Institute Lead for Smart Cities. He leads the university's involvement in a range of major research projects, and of course, including our project Triangulum. His presentation today will be about insights from 5 years of monitoring the Triangulum project. So James, I will now make sure that you can share your screen and then you can get started.
Thank you, Bettina.
Okay, you're all set. You can share your own screen now.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning. As Bettina said, myself, Kelly and Joe are based at the University of Manchester. We've been coordinating the monitoring and assessment across the project over the last 5 years. This has been a really interesting experience working with a very broad range of partners, as Bettina outlined, covering a very wide range of different kinds of demonstration projects. And at the same time, starting to think a little bit about the broader impact of what does this all add up to in terms of, yes, each of the projects is having specific impacts, saving carbon, reducing energy bills, hopefully improving user satisfaction. But if we're now operating in an era of zero carbon cities, rapid acceleration of transition to try and address climate change, then we need to start thinking a little bit more about what that all adds up to. What's Triangulum done in terms of changing the way cities operate? So those are the kind of different levels that we're thinking about and have started to think about. So I won't dwell on these slides. Bettina's already done a great job talking about the overview of the project. What I will talk a little bit about is this slide, which really captures the core of what Triangulum was trying to do, the logic, if you like, of real-world demonstration. So you can see at the bottom left here, the idea is if we trial new technologies in real-world environments, we should be able to generate evidence about performance and satisfaction and impacts with these technologies in real-world settings. So our job was really this second arrow, the impacts arrow. How do we capture the range of those impacts? And in the project application, which we wrote all that time ago, 6 years ago or something, these were the kinds of things we talked about: energy savings, sustainable mobility, citizen engagement, and broader socioeconomic benefits. We called it multi-level impact assessment and monitoring. And we framed that as monitoring at the level of the demonstration projects themselves. So what was each project, say, what was each smart grid or each sustainable mobility solution, what the impacts were. But we also wanted to know about impacts at the level of the district. So what do they add up to across an innovation district? And part of that was understanding the intersections between energy, mobility, and ICT. And then more broadly, we wanted to think about the impacts at the city level. But at the start of the project, we didn't have a clear idea what that would entail. So that's been a major finding, I think, for us over the 5 years, trying to understand impacts at these different levels. Kelly will say a bit more about that in the second presentation. And then, of course, once we've demonstrated, once we've captured some impacts, what's the point of doing this? The point of doing this is to undertake replication. So to try and roll out these technologies and solutions more broadly. Within the context of the Lighthouse projects, this was viewed as the follower cities implementing some of the solutions from the Lighthouse cities. Again, that process has not been quite as linear or straightforward as was anticipated at the start. The follower cities, I would suggest, have learned and replicated lots of things that they've seen demonstrated in the Lighthouse districts, but it hasn't tended to be specific technical solutions. Often it's been approaches to partnership working, the development of vehicles to access funding, understanding how you put together business plans for municipalities to convince them to try new things, understanding techniques for how you match up local needs with technology providers. So a lot of those things, in terms of the way that model was supposed to work from demonstration to impacts to replication, have worked out slightly differently than we thought. I'll just run through quickly some of the specific projects in each of the Lighthouse cities, just to give some context for what Kelly says next, so you have some idea what we're trying to monitor and where. So in each city, the demonstration projects were clustered into innovation districts. In Manchester, that was the Oxford Road Corridor, a partnership between two universities, a hospital, and the city council. The implementations focused on energy, a central energy management system to try and manage energy in a more efficient way across a whole range of buildings owned by different organizations. Visualization platform to make data available to researchers, to users. Electric cargo bikes, so that yellow snake down the middle is the Oxford Road. It now has Dutch style cycling infrastructure, which is a big deal if you live in the UK. And there was a feeling that we could trial electric cargo bikes to avoid last mile deliveries using this new infrastructure. And zero carbon assets, so solar PV, battery storage, in an attempt to make this area self-sufficient in energy. In Eindhoven, our second Lighthouse district, we had two innovation districts, contrasting types of district. Stripe S on the left, the old site of Philips factory, so a post-industrial site being regenerated into a mixed-use district. Eckhart Bartbrook on the right, very different, a residential district where the big challenges were around energy efficiency, retrofit of social housing, and how you engage residents and communities in that process. Some of the specific projects, smart street lighting, again, visualization of data through a platform, smart mobility management, and renewable energy. In Stavanger, a larger innovation area, two districts of the city, Paradise, Hilveg. Again, some similar solutions. This time, the mobility solution was focusing on electric buses and EV charging solutions. A renewable energy plant that heats a swimming pool, as well as a number of buildings. Smart homes and public buildings, these include offices, libraries and residences, so really a diverse set of use cases there. And smart video communication in homes and public buildings. And this is something that reflects, I guess, the topography of Norway. A lot of cities are quite disconnected due to fjords and mountains. So if you can develop effective smart video communications, you can cut down a lot of travel, a lot of air travel, and a lot of hassle. And Stavanger, we actually have funding to produce a cloud data hub as part of our monitoring and assessment work package, which was intended to store all of the impact data from across the three cities. Sorry, bear with me. Something's happened to the presentation. Why won't it click on? I'm just going to click out of the presentation a minute and share the screen again. It's just frozen for a second. Okay, can everyone see a picture again?
Yeah, thank you.
Good, sorry about that. Is it going to do it? I will just skip past that. And then the idea was to follow a cities, Prague, Sabadell, Leipzig, would be able to draw upon the evidence around the impacts of these projects and adopt these solutions in their cities. So some of the impact evidence went into the replication process, whereby the Lighthouse Cities demonstrations there were used to develop a replication tool for technology transfer, trying to understand the use cases around these technologies, and match up potential use cases to the needs of the follower cities. It became apparent quite quickly that clearly the needs in different cities are slightly different. So whatever the solution is, it needs to be tailored. And on the second side, an implementation strategy that really talked about softer skills, training people to be able to understand these solutions and how they work. There was an element of trial and error to the whole process. If anyone's on this webinar from one of the younger projects, that's a key message we'd like to convey to you. As I said at the start, in relationship to that figure showing the demonstration impact monitoring replication, it didn't work as simply or as smoothly as that in practice. There was a lot of trial and error around understanding what the impacts were, what impacts we could actually capture in terms of what data was available, what data could be shared with us, and then understanding what people in other cities would actually be interested in. So there was often different audiences wanting different things from data. So most of the data we collected on the specific demonstration projects, we gathered from the partners involved, who were very much interested in technical performance. Whereas if you talk about technology transfer, use cases, what potential customers are more interested in is return on investment and user satisfaction. So the way in which our monitoring framework evolved was quite dynamic, and we tried to co-produce it with the key partners involved, both the partners in demonstration, but also having workshops with the follower cities to understand what kinds of things they were interested in. And then at the same time, of course, we were trying to align with the European Union's emerging smart city metrics, first City Keys, and then later SCIS. So we were trying to understand what data was available, what our key audiences wanted us to monitor, and then whether that aligned with City Keys and SCIS. And the next three presentations will refer back to that process of how we tried to negotiate those different demands. Oh, my presentation really isn't very happy this morning. So there's only three slides left. I'm just going to describe them to you because the presentation has decided to freeze again. All right, here we go. It's coming. So Triangulum, what does it add up to? Well, we have the implementation of these 28 different technologies across infrastructure, building, applications, and technologies. They were translated into 70 use cases. So for example, the same technology in an office versus a hospital is separate use cases. We had a whole series of on-site interviews, workshops, and webinars to build expertise and training to enable people to understand how to adopt smart solutions. We then had our piece of the project, monitoring and measurability. We developed 242 indicators in the end based on 60 data sets. So they're data sets held by 60 separate partners or individuals in partner organizations. We also negotiated GDPR requirements, which came in partway through the project. If anyone's interested in that, we used the privacy impact assessment process. We can talk about that in the questions if anyone's interested. And then we talk, and then I guess the interesting thing over the 5 years is what that all has added up to in terms of accelerating smart cities in general, the city level impacts. A whole series of additional benefits at city level, organizational change, improved profile, improved public engagement, plus some really concrete co-benefits around spin-off companies, new projects and business initiatives. And Kelly will say a little bit more about that. These are some of the spin-offs and follow-on projects and initiatives. So I think I'll leave it there. Hopefully that's given you a better understanding of the overall project and how it stacks up, but also some idea of, I guess, the journey we've been on in terms of understanding what we should be monitoring, what it's important to monitor, what the kind of overall bigger picture benefits have been. Thank you.
Thank you very much, James, for this great overview about the monitoring of Triangulum. So I will share my screen again. Okay. So are there any super urgent questions right now? If so, we can take them immediately. If not, we can also save them for later when we have the general discussion round. But if anybody has an urgent question, we're happy to discuss it right away. Okay. That looks good. Okay, so let's continue with the second presentation of today. So the second presentation will be by Dr. Kelly Watson, also from the University of Manchester. Kelly has worked within the Triangulum work package for monitoring and evaluation for the past 3 years, and she has led on the collection and the assessment of impact data for the project. Besides working as a research associate at the University of Manchester, she also works as a senior consultant for an economic development consultancy in Manchester. Today, Kelly will provide an overview of monitoring and assessment at month 60, so the last month of our project Triangulum. So I will make you a moderator again, and then you can share your own screen. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Tina. Morning, everyone. So I'm going to follow on from James's presentation and give you, I guess, more of a snapshot around our specific work package, which looked at monitoring and assessment within Triangulum. So this work package, there's a series of different partner organisations that were involved. It was led from the University of Manchester. We worked with colleagues at the University of Stavanger and also the University of Technology in Eindhoven particularly, as well as colleagues from Manchester Metropolitan University and Fraunhofer to deliver our kind of monitoring and assessment work across the project. It was led from the University of Manchester, but we had input from these different colleagues within the other cities to gather data and information and feed this into our overall approach. This, I guess, gives a bit of a kind of broader picture of our overall context for what we were trying to achieve through the work package. So across the project, there was 2 years of implementation followed by 3 years of monitoring and assessment. However, underneath this is a kind of an overall model for how you start to think about capturing impacts. So in terms of implementation, this is the kind of the inputs and the processes related to the project. When we talk about monitoring an intervention, that tends to be around looking at the processes and the outputs of that intervention. However, in Triangulum, we really wanted to push more towards the kind of assessment end of this scale. And feel that we've really started to evaluate some of the outcomes and the impacts of the project. So this gives you an idea of how you can move from monitoring more towards evaluation and assessment within a project. As James has already shown, this is the kind of overall sort of project diagram, and you can see work package two sort of on the mid left. That's where we kind of fit in here. So capturing impacts from the demonstration projects in the lighthouse cities, and then feeding this information through to allow and facilitate replication in the follower cities. So the rest of this presentation is kind of giving you an overview of what we were doing as part of work package two. So our impact monitoring and assessment approach was multi-level within Triangulum. We started looking at module level impacts to begin with. This is something that we kind of focused on for the first 2 years of the monitoring and assessment period. But then this final year, we've increasingly looked at district level impacts and also city level impacts. So I'm going to take you through these one at a time and show you our approach to this. So in terms of module level, we've already heard that there was kind of three areas of focus for this: energy, mobility and ICT in the three lighthouse cities. And our module level impact work was trying to gather data and evidence from these modules across the three cities. Over the course of Triangulum, we've been involved in quite an intensive consultation process to work with our project partners to identify and specify the kind of the baseline indicators and the impact indicators and the data sets that would be used. So as James was saying, it really is something that was done in a kind of co-production format. It wasn't something that was set or predetermined. We worked with partners to set these indicators so that they were useful and kind of usable for those involved in the project. So by this point, by month 60, we've actually set 93% of the impact indicators have baseline values, and 91% are actually reporting impact data at this point. So you can see there's clearly there are challenges around this. It's not a straightforward process and it can be quite complex. So we're really pleased actually to have over 90% of our impact indicators generating data. You can see from the graph that there were some issues in Stavanger around sharing some data from certain partners. There were some kind of issues with GDPR and some privacy concerns, which is why there's some kind of issues there around reporting on some impact and baseline impact indicators. But overall, it's quite a strong performance across the three lighthouse cities. Our kind of key takeaways, I think, from this module level impact assessment is particularly around building trust and partnerships and relationships across the different project partners in the three cities. So some of our key learning is that actually international partnership working takes longer to kind of build and to form than those sorts of partnerships within the same city. And actually it's really key to sort of connect partners at an early stage of the project and get partners face to face. And this really helps to build those relationships and to build that trust and actually even to build that understanding about what data is needed and when. Face-to-face engagement is really key to this. So trying to get partners from different cities face-to-face at an early stage is something that we feel is important and worked well. And then as part of this, actually communicating in quite an open way and in a sort of holistic way is really important to overcome different cultures and different ways of working in different cities and in different countries. So it's also important actually within the same city in terms of overcoming some of the barriers in language or technical understanding across different partner organisations as well. clearly building relationships requires respect and kind of appreciation for the degree of involvement that's required or expected between partners. You need that common understanding of what you're expecting from each other, and that this is something that's important. If you can set these boundaries clearly at the start, this really helps. And then finally, kind of developing productive collaboration is really about working to the strengths of each partner, defining those roles and responsibilities clearly, and then working towards these strengths is we've kind of felt the best way to collaborate effectively. And it really encourages a more dynamic project progress as well. So in the final year of Triangulum, between months 48 and month 60, this is an overview of some of the key impacts that we've gathered and generated. So we've seen over 900 tonnes of CO2 saved in this year. There's been 120,000 kilowatt hours of renewable energy delivered in Manchester. In Eindhoven, 100% of the heating share and 14% of all energy share was met through the energy modules. In Stavanger, there were 56 residential smart gateways delivered, with 500 tonnes of CO2 avoided by the central energy plant. In the mobility modules, we've had across the three cities, there's a total of 10 electric vehicles, 4 cargo bikes, 17 charging stations and 5 battery buses operating. And this has saved over 100 tonnes of CO2 in the past year. And in terms of the ICT modules, we've got a total of 3 city data platforms and 1 cloud data hub with over 60 terabytes of storage. This is storing 17 real-time data feeds. And in Manchester, there's been 3 innovation challenges hosted in total. And in Eindhoven, there's been approximately €50 million of investment each year through the Startup Innovation Challenge hosted there. So some really kind of impressive results across the three cities in the final year of the project. However, we also have done some work to try and actually take these this impact evidence and put it into context. So we've done a case study from Manchester, and we've drawn on some recent sort of policy work that's been done in the city. So there's this scatter report, which was developed by Greater Manchester. And this is to look at the city's carbon budget from now until 2050. This report found that actually stationary energy use is almost 50% of the city region's energy use. And a quarter of that is around commercial buildings. So our idea was to take what we've done through the energy modules in Triangulum and upscale what those impacts would like if they were rolled out across the city region. So we've really rolled out our energy interventions across Manchester city centre. And if we upscale the impact data that we've gathered, it would equate to 54,000 tonnes of CO2 being saved each year. And if we extrapolate this across the time frame that this this policy report looks at, actually equates to almost 1.7 million tonnes of CO2 to 2050, which is over 11% of the city's carbon budget. So by doing something slightly different with the data and actually showing what it looks like when you scale it up and contextualise it within some wider policy drivers, you can start to show what these kind of module interventions mean at a different scale. And we found this quite a useful way of communicating the impact of Triangulum to different sorts of audiences in the city as well. And of course, alongside the immediate environmental impacts of scaling up, there'd be a whole series of other wider impacts that you could look at capturing as well. So impacts related to commercial cost savings, related air quality benefits and what that means for public health. There'd be some wider impacts around jobs supported and the skills associated with that in the city. And then there could even be some wider kind of city impacts around improving citizen awareness of this agenda, perhaps some education, some outreach opportunities, and even a new way for the city to kind of brand itself and have that kind of outward looking sort of competitive element as well. So as well as looking at the environmental impacts, you could look across this broader set of kind of socioeconomic impacts to get a real understanding of the wider return on investment of upscaling some of these interventions. So then moving on from module level impact assessment, we also are looking at district level. So this is actually something that we're undertaking currently because we're now in the very final month of the project. So we've just got in all of the final data from our city partners, And this week we'll be doing this district level monitoring, where we'll be kind of amalgamating impacts across the modules within each district and then comparing this to some of the original district level objectives that we gathered right at the start of the project. So this element is kind of still in progress. And then finally, the city level impact monitoring assessment. This is a separate process that we've developed through an impact framework across the city partners. And this is something that we've looked at across all six cities, so both the Lighthouse cities and the follower cities. And this is something that we've undertaken in the last year of the project. So one element of this has been looking at scaling up and contextualising those module level impacts, as I've shown you in Manchester in that example. We've also looked at leveraged investments and wider value of Triangulum. And then finally, we've looked at governance and propagation. And this is about the replication of processes as well as the replication of solutions across the cities. So our kind of process of doing this, first of all, we started off with a value mapping pilot piece of work. And this really looked at some of those kind of softer impacts that we've already discussed around partnership working, communication, relationship building. And it looks particularly at the potential for Triangulum to actually have an impact on the organisations involved. So what does this mean for the way those organisations operate and their standard practices moving forwards? They're starting to kind of work differently and realign themselves. Different teams are speaking to each other in different ways. And as a result, different organisations within a city are starting to kind of collaborate in new ways. So this is something that we wanted to kind of look at more and sort of try and gather more evidence for. And then similarly linked to this, we looked at spin-outs and leveraged investments across the three Lighthouse cities. So this is basically working with partners to gather information about any kind of initiatives, whether they're spin-outs, further funding grants, or kind of wider national demonstrator projects, as well as growth initiatives, sort of gather some evidence for the ways that Triangulum has helped to initiate new projects and new programmes. And then to gather some of this deeper evidence, we've then carried out a city level monitoring approach in the final year. So this has been a city partner survey that we've delivered across all six cities. And then we followed this up with some interviews specifically with some of the municipal partners. And then through some desk-based analysis, produced some final results, which are going into our final impact report this month. So our survey methodology was informed by the City Keys framework as well as the SCIS reporting requirements. So we tried to fold both of these things into our methodology. In terms of the City Keys framework, it specifically focused on the governance and the propagation questions within that framework. The people, planet and prosperity elements of City Keys, we felt that we'd already kind of dealt with these through the module level impact assessment, whereas we really focused in on the governance and the propagation to help us structure our city survey. So this survey was sent out, disseminated across the cities over the summer this year, last year. And then we followed up with the municipal interviews in September. What it's given us is a combination of kind of quantitative information as well as some more wider kind of qualitative context as well. But this is an example of the kind of questions that we asked. So we asked the city partners to kind of rate or to self-assess the impact of Triangulum on things like spin-off projects and initiatives, different types of impacts and benefits, and then also the impact on their organisation and their perspective on other organisations and other cities. So you can see we ended up with these kind of overall kind of assessments of how much Triangulum has impacted and how enduring that impact is going to be over time. So for us, it's been quite interesting that it's the spin-off projects and initiatives and also the impact on partners' own organisations that have scored quite highly here, which kind of reflects back to our wider city level monitoring approach. So then finally, just some key messages really coming out of our experiences in Work Package 2. Of developing a monitoring assessment framework for Triangulum. So key lessons really was working closely with partners and with relevant third parties was really, really key to build that trust and sort of build those communication channels. And this has really helped us to be able to deliver the kind of, you know, widespread data and impact assessment across the past 3 years. We've taken quite a hands-on approach to collecting that data, especially at a module level. So in Manchester, speaking from my own experience, we really actually went in and sat down with each project partner, sat with them, talked through the different impact indicators and worked out exactly what it was in within their data sets, the information that we would require. And this worked really well. Doing this about 3 years ago, it's really helped those communication channels and helped our partners understand what was required. But also we think it's important that we think about different types of value. So rethinking what impacts mean at district level and at city level has helped us as well to kind of produce a range of different sorts of evidence and different types of information. It's, you know, we've got a whole series of more technical and more environmental impacts that we have reported against. But equally, we've now got some more qualitative information about process learning and kind of organisational change as a result of Triangulum. So I think having both sides of that story is quite powerful. And in terms of opportunities, for us, it's about ensuring that the evaluation element of a Smart Cities project is really considered properly and designed in at the start of a project. It doesn't work if you try and kind of design these things in halfway through. It really needs to be there right from the start of a project. Capturing and sharing wider learning is really important. So how this links to broader forms of urban transformation and how it links to some softer barriers around kind of legal or institutional potential social barriers. I think this is a really useful kind of resource that's come out of Triangulum, is the start of gathering together some of this process learning. And then finally, looking at leveraging and capturing wider value around spin-outs and other forms of kind of projects and programmes, it was also told quite a strong story for Triangulum. So there are kind of methods out there to do this. And I think it's just about thinking about this at an early stage in the project to design it in at that point. Thank you. So, Christina, back over to you for any questions.
Thank you very much, Kelly. I saw that there was one question. Maybe we can just discuss that one right away. So the question was whether citizens recognize the actions and results in their cities.
I'll say something, then I'll pass over to James as well. I think probably our experience within Triangulum has been most partners have felt that it would have been great if perhaps there'd been more kind of citizen engagement throughout the project. I think there's certain cities that have been more successful at doing this than others. I think Eindhoven has done quite a lot of citizen engagement, hasn't it? But I think it probably comes down to the fact that Triangulum is one of the earlier Smart Cities Horizon 2020 projects, and potentially this is an element that's kind of been strengthened over time in some of the later projects.
Yeah, Dijuan from Eindhoven is speaking next about involving residents in retrofit. So that's one of the strongest, the most direct examples of public participation in Triangulum. There is one example that I think has been very instructive from Stavanger, who have developed a renewable energy source to heat the swimming pool that uses heat captured from a large sewer, a waste pipe underneath the swimming pool. So this is essentially dealing with sewage, human sewage from the city, and turning it into energy. And this has really been exceptionally powerful in terms of engaging residents of Stavanger, who seem to be intrigued by the idea that their waste products are being used to heat swimming pools and public buildings. And this has been an interesting case to look at, because that wasn't planned in the original description of work in Triangulum. Originally, that was going to be a heat pump. So it was something that emerged through trial and error. But equally, it shows how some technologies just do inherently enroll people in them. So just by using a toilet in Stavanger, you are part of that project, that smart city project. So that's been something I found quite fascinating. In Manchester, probably the cargo bikes are the things that have created most public engagement. And I think it's because they're visible. People see them cycling up and down the road. The challenge with some of the energy projects is it tends to be less visible. either panels on a roof or boxes put in basements in buildings. So certainly I think if our partners were going to design projects again, there'd be some really strong lessons around how to engage different communities.
Okay, thank you, James and Kelly. And thank you again, Kelly, for your presentation. So if there are no other urgent questions right away, I think we can continue with the third presentation today, which will be by Dr. Dujuan Yang from the Technical University of Eindhoven. Dujuan is an assistant professor of the Information Systems in the Built Environment, the ISBE group, at the Eindhoven University of Technology. She is a program manager of the university's Smart City program, which is called Urban Data and Data Platform. Her main areas of expertise are future urban mobility management with linked urban data, energy neutral city development, and decision support system in the context of smart city developments. Dujuan will be speaking about involving residents in monitoring energy retrofit projects. So as James just said, this is the perfect next presentation, taking up the questions just asked. Okay, Dujuan, so I will now give you the moderator rights, and then you can share your own screen and get started.
Thanks, Katina.
Okay, you should be able to share your screen now.
Yeah, I think I'm doing now, so I hope you can see my screen now.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for Kelly's presentation, which has gave a very nice overview about what we did for assessing the impact of the Triangulum project and also covered all three cities. So I'm going to guide you to dive into one of the projects within the Triangulum happened in the Eindhoven to show you how we accessed impact of this one particular project as one example. So the project is about the we assess the successfulness of the social house energy renovation. So in order to reduce the amount of energy consumption of the buildings, I think you all know that EU created the Energy Performance of Building Directive and Energy Efficiency Directive. So to reduce energy consumption of the social house part in Netherlands, the government and association for tenants created energy saving covenant for the rented sector. One of the goals is that the total housing stock of all housing corporations should have at least an average energy index of 1.25, which equals to the energy label B. So now in the Netherlands, we have around 2.4 million drawings. A large amount of existing drawings of the house corporation are built before 1975 and have a poor energy efficiency because of the missing of the legislation. But overall, they have quite low comfort level for the tenants. Therefore, the social housing we think it can play a very important role in the reduction of the energy consumption in the Netherlands. Meanwhile, the renovation should increase tenant satisfaction due to the comfort arising. So for renovation of a house complex in the Netherlands, 70% of the tenants should accept the proposal if it's a more than 10 house need to be renovated from the social house. Including the rent increasement, they have to agree about that. So overall, there is a valid energy label obligation for the landlords, for the social house associations, and the housing cooperation have the opportunity to increase slightly a bit of the rent when the energy label improves, and only if it is reasonable. So this is the current social house situations in the Netherlands. So in the Triangulum project, there is a living lab areas, as already mentioned in Kelly's presentation. But this one is located in the Eichert-Fahrtbruck district of Eindhoven. It is a residential area. So the energy efficiency renovation were planned to be carried out on the social house stock that predominates in this area. As you can see from these figures, that most of these houses have relatively low energy labels. There are two houses at level S, 47 houses at level E. So we want to renovate these houses to energy level at least level B. So the Triangulum project started in 2013, and the social house company started project at end of the 2013 with initiative and the performance phase. Later, the definition and design phase took place. During the design phase, the project manager and the purchasing managers selected the contractors for the project. The preparation phase took quite some time. From the April to September 2018, at that moment, our tenants received the invitation letter containing information about some measurements and explaining that the tenants themselves could decide to renovate, how they could make the choice, and which are the follow-up steps they have to take. I'll show you in the figure, this is the customer journey developed by the social house company. From the point that they received the information, the power to start the renovation phase lay with the tenants. So the tenants could decide when to start the renovation. Once they decided to start the renovation, they called the social house company to make appointment for a home visit. Prior to the home visit, the social house company sent an information booklet to the tenants with information about the basic packages and additional measures they can take, and also informed them about the follow-up steps that they would have to take. During the home visit, an employee of the social house company discussed the measures and questions and also the wishes with the tenants gathered using an IT tool named MoonConnect. MoonConnect is an IT-based instrument which can model the cost and yield it in a 3D visualization with all the renovation options. It helps help the tenants to make the renovation decisions by visualizing, see the visualized figures, and also help them to understand the energy consumption reduction after the renovation better. These results were in a concept offer in MoonConnect than the tenants was received. So within 2 weeks after the home visit, after 2 weeks, the contractor came to measure their property and discussed with tenants about their planning and their wishes possibilities. So all the renovations within the Triangulum project, which were 74 houses, have been finished by the end of January 2019. So in this project, the tenants had the opportunity to select the energy measures for the renovation, as I mentioned before. So there are two packages. One is the basic package, as you can see that it includes facade, the ground and first floor, the roof options, the safety options, and also the attic options. There is also additional package that they can choose to do the renovation. It includes insulation above windows, replace kitchen, bathroom, or toilet, insulation wall in the storage room, or separate attic room, or move bathroom. to assess the impact of energy renovation projects, we really want to know how does renovation process, including the level of participations that affect the satisfaction level of the tenants and the energy reduction. So we conducted a questionnaire. The questionnaire is not only restricted to the this project in the Triangulum, so we also conducted three other projects which has been completed by the same social house company, Wombdive, but in different projects. So the data was collected in the months of April and May 2019. And the beginning of April, the tenants received a letter from the social house company in which they were told that there are a student will come to complete the questionnaire face to face. The reason why we use a face-to-face way to ask for the questions because we want to increase participation of the tenants. We were told it's not very easy to reach them and ensure that the questionnaires were completed correctly. So if they have any questions regarding the question we ask, we can answer them directly. So for the Triangulum project, we collected 30 houses. They agreed to accept our visit and completed the face-to-face questionnaire. As I mentioned, we also want to know their energy reduction, but at the moment when we ask them whether they are willing to share their energy consumption data, most of them withdraw their interest because due to variety of the problems. Some of them switch their energy company, so they have not any access to their previous energy company the data, so they cannot give us their data. And most of them think this is too much trouble for them get this data digitally. And some of them also conserve their privacy. So in the end, we only succeed to collect six households' energy consumption data. Considering the energy consumption data before the renovation part, the data of the annual energy bill was asked from the tenants. We were staying around their house, and if they need our help, we help them to search on their energy company website and help them to log in and get their energy bill. And only one or two houses has installed a smart metering, so that if they have smart meters, so that's easier for us to collect the data. So four of these houses were obtained by the annual energy bill. So for the energy consumption data after the renovation, we have to find out different methods to calculate their energy consumption data as shown in the figure. Some of them, because they can decide when they want to do their renovation, when they did their renovation. So we did not fit to get all these the houses can share their yearly energy consumption data after renovation. So if they have the annual yearly completed after the renovation, we can get either annual energy bill, we collect the data from smart meter. Or if they are not a complete year, so we use the method to ask the energy bill twice, energy consumption data twice. So we have measurement one and measurement two, so for a certain period. So we extrapolate the energy consumption data to a year. Now I would like to share with you some results we found out from this data analysis. So past analysis was applied to analyze the model. I will not bother you with the model itself, so I will mainly show you what we have found. So we found that tenants' overall satisfaction was affected by both the satisfaction of the results and also the satisfaction of the process. Comparing to the process, the results have a higher impact. For the satisfaction of the process, it has influenced by the communication with the tractor, whether tenants have influence on the process, whether the process has created quite some discomfort, and the communication with house association. For the satisfaction of the results, it has been influenced by also the communication with the contractor, which shows that the contractor do have a very important role in this overall satisfaction to make the tenant satisfied. Also the satisfaction of the energy measures after renovation, but more important is their comfort after the renovation. So for both sides, we also found that the comfort or the discomfort during the process has played a more important role compared to other factors for the tenant's satisfaction. So we suggested to the social house company that if in the future they would like to increase their satisfaction in their renovation project, they probably should pay more attention to what are tenants' current comfort level, what are their expectations regarding comfort after renovation, and what kind of discomfort they could accept during the renovation process. For the energy reduction part, we calculated both the theoretical change before and after renovation and actual change. Overall, the energy consumption reduced. However, considering the theoretical change that was expected the tenants will have a high energy saving due to the renovation because PV panels were installed for 4 out of 6 tenant house in this area, in this sample, 6 sample. However, there was not as much saving as expected. This may be explained by the overestimation of the theoretical energy consumption. We also found aligned with other literature, they found that the same results that the theoretical energy consumption significantly reduced per energy label, but while in the reality, the decrease in energy consumption is less compared to this theoretical calculation decrease. So which means that the drawings with a larger difference between the energy labels before and after renovation, the potential energy saving is not only overestimated by the theoretical calculation comparing to the dwellings with a smaller change of their energy labels. Moreover, many tenants during our face-to-face interviews, the questionnaires, they also mentioned that they knew the measures such as LED lighting and devices with a higher energy label will save energy, or if they can be used in a different way, will save energy. But they are not quite sure about how that changes could happen in their daily life and how it will be influenced, what are the impact on their energy bill in the end. So therefore, it is also quite important, we think, to educate the tenants about the changes they can make in their behavior after the renovation. To some special cases, such as the houses which has installed the PV panels, you may also consider to educate the tenants about how to use the renovated house more energy efficiently. Maybe showering a different time, open the dishwashers and the washing machine during the day instead of during the evening. So there should provide more information after the renovation, which could really lead to the energy reduction. So that's all about my presentation, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dujuan. That was very interesting. So we have one final presentation, but before we go to that one, are there any urgent questions right away? Okay, then I think we can just go to the last presentation of today, which is by Joe Lycoris from the University of Manchester. Joe has a master's degree in chemistry, and he has worked in energy management for behavior change. And he is currently leading on the completion of the Triangulum data onto the Smart Cities Information System, the database. And he also supports the University of Manchester with the final report for Manchester. Joe will speak about the insights from combining the Smart Cities Information System with Triangulum today. And we are very excited to learn more about this. So thank you very much, Joe. I will now give back the screen to James, and then you can get started.
Thank you, Bettina. Good morning, everybody. I'll just see if I can get this monitor set up. Is it?
That's the one.
Great.
That should be the one.
Okay, wonderful. So this is what I'm going to be covering today. It's insights from combining SCIS with Triangulum. So I'm going to be covering what is SCIS, why we're using it, some SCIS issues, which is a nice little pun on the issues we've had with SCIS, solutions to those issues, how Triangulum achieved integration as we're a legacy project and SCIS is a relatively new platform, and future suggestions for how projects can involve their data collection and transfer into SCIS. Great. So what is SCIS? SCIS is the Smart Cities Impact Reporting Tool for Horizon 2020 and beyond projects in the EU. It enables smart cities to compare solutions so that we don't have to keep repeating the same interventions, and city stakeholders can understand what best solutions to implement in their cities. This is a screenshot of the top of one of the impact modules. So generally this you have a description, and then plenty of KPIs are generated by the platform. So why do we use it? It's to target technology uses. So the smart cities projects that have been running in the EU starting in 2015 have been investigating the effects of implementing specific technologies such as solar panels, EV deployment, cargo bikes, using sewage to power municipal swimming pools. So we want to be able to provide this information in a condensed way to other partners so that they can implement appropriate cities in their, implement solutions in their cities so that we can increase the replication of these projects. And so that should reduce the time for research and therefore implementation. So the SCIS issues that we have faced come into four broad categories. So because Triangulum started in 2015 and SCIS was really requested at the start of 2019, so before then it was a spreadsheet, and early 2019 it became a website, we had to figure out a way of reverse engineering our project modules and KPIs that we've been building on for 3 years into this platform. The rigid structure of SCIS means that there are limits onto what we can report. So if we are collecting specific KPIs for an infrastructure change and SCIS doesn't provide sections for them to be reported into, we struggled to decide how to report the impacts of those interventions. There are many KPIs available through SCIS. So this is, it's a way of capturing as much as possible, but each time all the KPIs are generated for that specific intervention so that the platform can compare what is happening in each of the projects. But it often seems like that we have to report on lots of KPIs that seem irrelevant for our project from the beginning. So we have to figure out what's relevant. And then information flow from partners. This is something that is difficult in a large scale project as there's many, many partners. So we have 22 partners on this project. And sometimes I'll have subcontractors, and SCIS requires financial information to work effectively. And this is often quite difficult to get from commercial partners. So the solutions that we found to these SCIS issues, we had in Prague, we had a presentation and a workshop to identify problems. So this really started off the discussion across the work package 2 group of how we're going to address SCIS and how we're going to appropriately report our project modules. Regular communication between not just inter-project, but we're between the project and SCIS. So having meetings in Barcelona, myself and Rudy met to discuss some of the SCIS issues that we're facing, and regular Skype calls. Off the back of the regular communications that we had and the questions that were generated, Work Package 2 developed a handbook for common reporting so that we can align the way that we report our projects. This handbook is going to be available after the presentation in PDF format. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them after this presentation, but most of them should be covered. Most general questions should be covered in the handbook. And then rationalizing project data. So I've covered this a few times, but it's making sure that our impacts are appropriately reported through the SCIS system. So that might be converting litres of fuel into kilowatt hours, as SCIS requires energy to be reported in a very specific way so that projects can be compared. So rationalizing project data was one of the solutions we found to the rigidity of SCIS. So comparative metrics is how we achieve integration. As I've just said, converting litres into kilowatt hours. Gathering data outside the project. So we had to go back to partners and discuss with them how we were going to gather and report on requests made by the EU and SCIS to improve our reporting. And recording problematic reporting areas so that Work Package 2 as a whole could come to a common reporting solution that aligned with SCIS. So future suggestions, continuing cross-project communication. So myself and James are members of the SCC 1 monitoring assessment group. They meet regularly to discuss monitoring, and SCIS comes up in those meetings. For projects that have members on that board, it will be useful to keep communicating about SCIS. Meetings with SCIS and project assessors. So SCIS is continuously being updated with new formats and forms, and to improve clarity. So for example, positive energy districts is a type form is a module that's being developed and implemented very soon. So discussions with SCIS about the most appropriate way to report these next generation infrastructure changes into SCIS will be useful. Continuing update of SCIS from project feedback. So SCIS will continue to help as far as they can. And then clarifying data requirements early with partners. So we weren't able to do this as a project because we couldn't confirm that we needed lots of financial data specifically from partners, or the number of citizens engaged for certain interventions. So really laying out what's required by SCIS along with the impact indicators that you'll be reporting for your generic report for the EU. Highlighting them to partners early on will reduce the confusion and improve communication. So that's the end of the quite a quick whistle stop tour of SCIS. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them now. No? Okay, well, I'll hand back to Bettina then. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Joe, for this presentation about SCIS, which I think is a really important part of the community, because we all have to report to the SCIS database, and it's really helpful to get like an inside view into this topic. So thank you very much, Joe. So now we are at the end of our 4 presentations. Let me just change back to my screen. So we now still have some time for questions regarding all 4 presentations. So on the screen, you can see an overview of the 4 presentations that we had. So now I would like to open up to general questions. So if you have any question to any of the 4 speakers, you can just unmute yourself and directly speak, or if you prefer to put it into the chat box, that's also fine, and then I'll read it. Okay, so we have one question in the chat box. Are there public events of SCIS? Where can we find the recordings of all PowerPoints? So these are two questions. Joe, do you know anything about public events of SCIS?
I'm not aware of all the public events that SCIS has hosted, but I can contact SCIS and get back to you. I'm not sure if they are, they have a lot of forms online. So if you go to SCIS EU, it should be the first link. They have loads of information on there. There should be PowerPoints, but I'm not aware of every event that SCIS hosts publicly. I can find out more information for the group.
Yeah.
So can you tell me a bit about how you've been talking to SCIS?
So I've been communicating through lots of different platforms. So email, Skype, and face-to-face meetings where I can. But Skype has been the most effective way of communicating because I can bring other members of the project into those discussions so that there's no miscommunication from from project me to Ruby, who's the main careholder of SCIS. But it's been quite efficient online meetings, really, in gathering data, gathering questions beforehand and proposing them to Ruby so that he can formulate answers to these.
Yeah, so I know that there are also like instruction tag codes regarding the use of the SCIS platform. They are not public, as far as I'm informed. They are rather internal. But if anybody from the participants is interested in learning more about the platform, you can just send an email to info@smartcities-infosystem.eu and then basically request to be paired with somebody who can give you this information. Or also at their website, they have an events section where they also always update the latest events that are planned. And then the second question was where the PowerPoints presentations can be found. I think this is probably related to this webinar. So the webinar in itself will be uploaded to the Triangulum webinar section and also to the YouTube channel. If that's okay with all four speakers, I can also upload PDF versions of the presentations to the website, to the news section. So you can find it there probably tomorrow if you want to have another look.
Thanks, Bettina. Just one thing I'd also add, I should have put it in the presentation. All of our deliverables for monitoring and assessment are publicly available on ResearchGate. So if you go to ResearchGate and search Triangulum, it will pull up the project page and you can see our deliverable on monitoring framework, baseline report, the impact report so far, and our final impact synthesis report will be up there in a couple of weeks. So all of the detail of what we've talked about is publicly available through ResearchGate.
Yeah, and they are also at the Triangulum website. Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay, we have some more time for another question. There is one.
Yep. Hi, guys. Can you hear me?
Hi, Delia.
This is Delia speaking.
Hi.
Hi. I don't have a question, but more of kind of a comment or to add something. In the presentation, I think, of Kelly about the impacts and follow-up or the additional results, let's say, I think next to the UNALAB project, we should add the synchronicity project. Probably you have heard about that, which builds up actually from our perspective, participation of Eindhoven, build up on the results of Triangulum. So this is a spin-off, that's the word I was looking for. That's a very good spin-off to be mentioned from the municipality side, which was the base, had the base in Triangulum, and then we went further to develop our urban data platform, where we want to use it now to build up and to gather the data and to keep the data from all the use cases running in the city. So I think from the data perspective, it's a very important spin-off, which was produced from the Triangulum project. So we can use that as a, one of the important results from the data perspective.
That's great. Thanks, Delia. We'll definitely add that into the table for the final report.
There's also, we've produced across all of the work packages in Triangulum, an exploitation report, which captures all of the results and follow-on projects that have come out of Triangulum and gives details about them. Bettina, do you have any idea whether that document will be available as well?
I think it will be included in the report, but I'll double check. I can also check with Trinidad. She's the coordinator of our project to all others, and I can check with her how we can make that available.
Maybe I can say something for that, Charlotte. So as the exploitation plan and report is included in our periodic reporting, it will be confidential. And if we make something public, this has to be discussed then with the partners. But in the first instance, it's a confidential document.
Okay, thank you. Okay, are there any other questions?
Maybe one comment also from my side regarding the exploitable results that are publishable. At the moment, we are preparing fact sheets that will be published on also on the website. So there we will have public available information for everyone.
Yeah. Yeah, in general, like if you are interested in learning more about what Triangulum has achieved, what were the main outcomes, you can just have a look at our website. There we also have a brochure that we prepared last year that summarizes like the main outcomes for each city and also for the fellow cities. And in general, at our website, you will find many different resources about Triangulum and its results, and of course also contact information. So in case you have a more specific like request or question, you can always also contact specific people to address them. Okay, so if there are no more questions, I would like to thank again our four speakers. So thank you very much to James, Kelly, Dujuan, and Joe for taking the time to prepare these presentations and for making sure that we understand what Triangulum and the main outcomes were about.
Thank you very much. Thank you everyone for joining. Thank you, Bettina, as ever, for organizing it so smoothly. We hope that's been of some use to people listening. Please, as I say, watch out for our final report in a month, which will follow up on a lot of these issues that we've raised here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And also one more information. The final Triangulum newsletter will be published this week, since this is not only the final month of Triangulum, it's also the final week. So Friday will be our last day. And before that, we will make sure to publish our final newsletter, which will be different in that we prepared one-page summaries for each of our cities. So if you really want to know what are the main outcomes of the project, like really concise in one page per city, watch out for our newsletter. You can sign up for it at our website. And then you have like a nice summary of Triangulum in one PDF. Okay, so thank you very much again, also to all the participants for joining today and for exchanging discussions with us. And thank you also for the support during the last 5 years. Many of you were there from the beginning. So thanks a lot, and hopefully see each other soon somewhere. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.